First thing we're going to do is set our current project to a new project. So here on our brand new Maya, we haven't even opened a file yet. Our current project is set to default. So if we click on this folder right here, now you can see that I have access to different things. So I can type a new name in right here, or I can add a new folder. Create a new file this way. So I'm going to set that. So Maya warns me, hey, there's not anything in there yet. We're going to create a workspace. And now here on my current projects, I have that file available to me, right? And if I jump over here, this is Documents Maya Projects. I can see there's that tutorial series folder. There's my workspace file, and this contains all my settings for the all the files that we're going to work with in this project folder. So the first thing that we want to be able to do for your exam study guide is to adjust our scene basics. Okay, so we're going to focus on these three skills right here. So changing the grid spacing, one thing that I want to do here in the modeling, I can go to display and then grid, and you'll see these boxes every once in a while. You see here I have arrows, which means that there's more options, and I have this box, which means that there are more options here too. Now, if I just click here on grid, that's going to turn the grid off. What I want to do is turn the grid on and select this box to give me the options. So you can see here, these are my options for my grid. Now, my length and width is set to 12, and I have grid lines every 5 units. So I'm going to change that. I can make that 100. All right, I'm going to keep the other two things the same. I'm going to apply and close. Now you can see my grid is much larger. Right, so I have a much larger grid for my scene now. So I can also go into Windows Settings Preferences, and in my settings, I have access to these. So these are what units we're working in. So here in the US, we might be more comfortable with inches or feet. If we're working on a larger scene, we might choose a yard or a meter. Right, so you can adjust these. Now in angular, your options are degrees or radians. I'm more comfortable with degrees, I'm gonna leave that. And here you can see your up axis can be changed. I'm gonna leave that with Y. So if we save those settings, now you can see we're getting some clipping here because our grid is so much larger because we changed it from centimeters to yards. All right, last thing, we want to adjust our frame rate. Now you can see here at the bottom, we have a really quick drop down. We can adjust our frame rate. So if we want something that felt more stop motion-y, we might adjust it down to 12 frames per second. You can see you can also take it higher, right? If you're looking for something that's in HD GoPro, you might adjust it to 120 frames per second. And you can see here your frame numbers are going to change when you adjust that. I'm going to put this back on 24 frames per second. One more thing I want to show you is if you play your scene, if we just press play, it's going to go way faster than 24 frames per second. And changing this won't change that. So if we go to our playback menu here, and I can see I'm in the animation workspace on playback, playback speed. You can see right now it's set to play every frame free, right? That just means play every frame as fast as you can. What we want to do is real time. And that is going to make it so it plays at 24 frames per second. So in this video, we're going to start to talk about scene objects and how to manage them and keep them organized. So if we jump over to Maya, you can see here I have this scene. Giving everything a nice little Lambert texture just to help us keep it organized. And you can see I have a ground cylinder, a sphere, and then I have this little guy I put together out of a bunch of cubes. Everything is just default names default shapes. So this is not super organized. This is not going to help me understand what I have and how to manipulate it. So what I want to do is start to organize things a little bit. So this ground plane right here, I'm going to rename that. And then this cylinder, we could select that by clicking on it. I'm going to name that house. And over here I have all. And then I have my little person. Well, this person is made up of lots of different pieces. So I'm going to select each piece and I'm going to name it what part of the body it is. And then that's going to be its right leg. And that'll be the left leg. All right, and so then I'm going to start to organize this shape and keep it all one piece. So I'm gonna make the main top level of this the torso. So the child of the torso is gonna be the head. And the way that I can do that is just by dragging the picture right here and dropping it on torso. And so now there's this little plus sign, open that up. You can see the head is a child of torso. I'm gonna do the same thing with left leg and right leg. So drop left leg in there, drop right leg in there. All right, and then if I made a foot, then the foot could be the child of left leg, the other foot could be the child of right leg, right? And then arms and hands, I could organize that the same way. So you can see you can start to get pieces that build up in a good way by using this hierarchy system. Now, if I move my person, you can see that all the parts of the person move together. I can also make all of these a child of the ground so that I can move the ground all together. So if I drag torso into ground, you can see now ground, and then house into ground, and then ball into ground. Now when I select ground, my whole scene moves together as well. And you can collapse that to keep everything nice and organized. All right, so that's how you can organize your scene. Now, select grouping parenting. We've covered that. Now we want to talk about duplication. All right, so a lot of times what kids want to do is select an object and control C, control V, right? And then they have another ball object, but we have this group. And then we have pasted ground one, and then we actually have the mesh of the ball, right? And it doesn't retain our nice name. It doesn't retain any of the things that we wanted, and it's got all of this wasted data. I'm gonna just go ahead and hit delete on that. So then how can we duplicate the right way? Well, if we go to edit, you can see here are all of our options. Right? I can duplicate, I can duplicate special, and then I can duplicate with transform. And here are your hotkeys for that. Control D, Control Shift D, Shift D. Now, if I duplicate special, you can see we've got one of those boxes. So I'm gonna click that box, and you can see that we can create copies or instances. And an instance is a special kind of duplication that is going to take up less data. So if you're going to make something that has lots of copies, like a leaf, you might want to do instances instead. But we don't want to duplicate special. We're just going to do a normal duplicate. So I'm going to press Control D. And there you go. You can see you just have the mesh. It retains the name of the original with the one after it, right? And it's going to also take its material with it as well. Okay, so that is the easy duplication. Control D is the way that you would duplicate an object. Now I can duplicate the whole person here, Control D. And then you can see here inside torso, I have head, left leg, right leg, right? And so that will duplicate all of the bits. All right, back over to our study guide. Now, navigate and rearrange hierarchies in the outliner. That's what we've been doing this whole time. This is our outliner. Sometimes it'll go away, But this bottom button here will bring it back. And your outliner is going to be the best tool for making sure that you know where all your pieces are and what they are. Okay, this is going to fill up with all the objects in your scene. Manage and organize display layers. So our display layers are here in our channel box. You can see it's called the channel box slash layer editor. And you can see I've adjusted my layers a little bit. And I have a cylinder layer, a ground layer, and a pasted ground layer. You get these four buttons, right? I can move my layers up and down in the list, create a new layer. I can create a new layer and assign, right? So I'm going to go ahead and do that. I'm going to create a new layer and assign selected objects. You can see that our second duplicated person is there. So I'm going to select that. You can see our new layer is called layer one. If we double click that, it opens up our edit layer box. So we can name it. This can be person two. I'm going to save that. All right, so now here, person two, you can see we have these three boxes. So we're gonna click those and see what they do. So if I click on the V stands for visible, right? So you can quickly turn off a lot of objects in a scene with the V button. The P button stands for playback, right? So you can see it's all here in our scene. We're not seeing anything change here in our scene, but in playback, that would go away. And then this last button, T, R, or empty. Okay. You see T is wireframe. R is something else. And normal is the empty, right? We have options to add objects to layers, right? So if I selected the sphere and I wanted to add it to the ground layer, we can add selected objects to that person too. And that's how you can change the layer that something is on. Now, if something's a child of a layer, then it's always going to be controlled by what happens to its parent object. All right, so if I select the cylinder, can remove selected objects from ground, but it's still controlled by ground, which is its parent object. So if I wanted that house to not disappear when ground disappears, I'm gonna have to take it out of being a child of that layer, okay? All right, so why do we use layers? Well, when you are compositing and rendering, layers help you separate the different grounds of your object, your foreground, your midground, your background, so that you can control what you're rendering to each shot and then control separately and dial in with precision the way that you want that to appear in your shot. All right. So as we're working, we want to think about what needs to be in the foreground, what needs to be in the midground, what needs to be in the background. Are we going to have dust? Are we going to have smoke? How can we dial in those special effects? How can we dial in our color palettes on each section of our shot in order to make sure that we get the results that we're looking for? Okay. And so that's why we're going to use these layers as a way to control precisely the render that we want.